beginning of the Bible. Jesus is at the end of the Bible, right?
No!
Where do we find Jesus in the Bible?
Everywhere,
from beginning to end. It's all about him, and we're going to see that in the life of Moses. Let's talk about Moses for a second. We had a very confident, brash young man. Grew up in the courts of Pharaoh, the king of the greatest country in the world, the most powerful country in the world. He had anything he wanted: chariots, gold, friends, anything. And he was amazing. And he thought, wow, I can lead my people. He sees an Egyptian being unjust towards one of the Hebrews, and he murders that Egyptian. That is sometimes what young people do. We can be very impulsive. That's not God's plan. That was not going to be his way. God was going to use Moses, but God needed to change Moses. God needed to humble Moses. So Moses became a fugitive. He was on the run because he killed an Egyptian. If he gets caught, death penalty for him. So he goes into the wilderness and joins the people of Midian and marries a Midianite woman. Together, they take care of these disgusting creatures that sometimes come into your house. You know the creatures that I mean? They eat out of your refrigerator. They leave crumbs everywhere. They don't clean up their room. They cost a ton of money. They're called children. Right. They had adults. Well, some adults are like that too. And they had children. And then, as an old man, Moses is in the wilderness, and he sees a bush that's on fire. That's not a big deal. That happens. But this bush wasn't being consumed. That's a miracle. And that happens. The leaves were staying green, and they weren't getting all ashy and nasty and disgusting and falling apart. And out of the bush came a voice: Moses, Moses, I am the Lord your God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Take off your shoes, for this is holy ground. And only slaves were to take off their shoes in the presence of their master. Once Moses was the master, now he's been humbled to be a slave. And he's okay with that. And God says, I have seen the cry, I have heard the cry of my people, I have seen their toil, and I'm going to send you. And Moses, the one who 40 years ago was ready to do it, now he's like, no, not me, I can't even speak. And God says, I give words. I'm the one that makes people speak. You'll speak if I give you power to speak. And Moses is like, yeah, that's a good answer, God. Okay, you got me on that one. But no one will believe me. And God says, well, with your hand, you will do great signs and wonders. And Moses is like, yeah, that's a good point. Okay. But I don't even know your name. And God says, I am the eternal one. I am that I am. That's who I am. Send someone else. And Moses is scared. And I love that God uses scared, timid, untalented people. Because that's me. I get that way too. If God can use Moses, he can use me. He can use you. He can use anybody, because it's God who does it. When we saw those terrible plagues yesterday that teach us that sin is serious, Moses went before Pharaoh, let my people go, 10 times. And 10 times Pharaoh hardened his heart and said, no, I don't know your God, and I will not listen to your God. And God did mighty, horrible, terrible plagues. The Nile turned to blood. Frogs all over the place. And not cute Kermit the Frogs. I mean nasty, slimy frogs that pee and poop all over the place. And gnats and locusts and boils on your skin. Even the sorcerers that were into satanic worship, even they were like, this is the finger of God. Was that Moses doing those miracles?
No.
No, it was God doing the miracles through Moses. God can do miracles through you, through me. Are we going to have hardened hearts like Pharaoh?
No,
there you go, I like it. Love it. Or are we going to have soft hearts? Right, because when we read about this, it's not like reading history, like, oh, I'm going to read about what happened at the Battle of Hastings, and isn't that interesting, and it just, stimulates my mind. No, reading the Bible is not like that. When we read the scriptures, it's not just, oh, isn't that neat what happened then? No, this teaches us about our relationship with God now. We learn about God's character, how he uses sinful, broken people like Moses, like me, like you. That's what we're learning in this. This has relevance to today. And one of the greatest miracles that you will find in the history of the world is that the Jewish people were slaves in Egypt you. Great. 16 times we're slaves. You don't even remember anyone that wasn't a slave. You can never say, well, remember that time when we heard about, you know, great uncle, you know, whatever, so-and-so, he wasn't a slave. No, there wasn't any of that. 16 generations, you felt hopeless. Have you ever felt hopeless?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have. I don't like feeling hopeless. And God sees you. There is always hope. Always. And we see that in the account of Moses. Because when you have all those Hebrew people under the oppressive thumb of the king of Egypt, the most powerful king in the world, with the most powerful military, with the greatest wealth, with the more chariots and more armor bearers and more swordsmen than anybody else, you want to know what a miracle is? Is that God freed the slaves. That's amazing. I think it's amazing that the slaves got freed in this country. That's terrific. Should have happened sooner. But we were not as powerful as Egypt was. We did not own slaves for as long as they did. They owned slaves for so long. It was so part of who they were, how they built their cities, how they got their work done. And God freed the slaves. We call this the Exodus. Exodus literally just means leaving. You ever been in a building? Sometimes there's a sign that says exit. Well, it comes from the same word, Exodus. And we get the second book of the Bible. It's called Exodus because it talks about the leaving of the Hebrew people from Egypt. And the Hebrew people had a really big problem. You know what their problem was? They don't have any heads. But you know what? There's so many of them. I don't even know that I can paint enough heads of them. So many. The scriptures say that there were 600,000 men. So if there were 600,000 men, approximately how many women do you suppose there were? Probably about 600,000, right? It's about 50-50 approximately. That's about, who can do math? That's 1,200,000 people. But they get those little creatures that show up when you get men and women together. So let's say every man and woman have like two children. That means if they only had two children, there would be more than 2 million Hebrews freed at once. To MIL plus. 2 million plus. That's a lot of people. And where are they going to go? Before we talk about that, we have to realize, understand, this is a big deal. What would make the Pharaoh let 2 million plus slaves go? It begins with an M. That's right. It's a miracle. It's a miracle that God freed the slaves. And why can the Lord, the true God, why does he have power to do miracles? A miracle is just when God suspends normal science for a moment. Something that doesn't usually happen happens. Like a man walking on water. That doesn't typically happen, but God can make it happen. You know, there's all kinds of miracles that happen in the Bible. And this is one of them, that God freed the Hebrew slaves. You know why God can do that? I can't do miracles, not in my own power. You can't do it either. But God can. Because unlike the false gods of Egypt, the true and living God, he's not just powerful, he's not just mighty, he's not just amazing. He's almighty. Almighty, which means he's the most mighty. There might be mighty people in the world that can do amazing things, but nobody is as mighty as our God. And there's even an extra box at the end, because that's for the exclamation point. Exclamation point is Hebrew for really, 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 really a lot. That's what that means. God is almighty, not the gods of Egypt, and not the gods of the United States of America. We might think that our president is special, and you know what? He is an amazing man, but he's not almighty. We might think that our favorite football quarterback is amazing, and they are impressive, but they are not as the almighty. We might think that we're pretty impressive. Called narcissism. Look into it. You know what? And some of us are pretty great, but we're not the Almighty. Whatever it is that's an idol in our life does not compare to the true God. That's why idolatry, we talked about idolatry yesterday, that's why idolatry is so foolish. Because whatever it is that we're putting our worship into is not better than the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. whatever you're worshiping that's not God is inferior. It's a trifle. It's ridiculous. So only worship Him. When I go someplace, I use a GPS. Who likes a GPS? I like a GPS because it just tells me what to do. As a man, it's great. Women, would you please, when you get married someday, be a GPS. Just tell your husband what you want, okay? Don't do all kinds of games and code and passive-aggressive nonsense. Just tell us what you want. I like the GPS. It tells me, turn right, turn left. If I make a mistake, it's nice to me. It says, okay, let's find a new route. What is it? Dude, you are so old school. A compass? Next thing you're gonna tell me about paper maps. No, the GPS. Now they didn't have a GPS. They didn't have a global positioning system back then. They had God's positioning system. Because here's the deal. The Israelites didn't know where to go. They knew they were going to a land flowing with milk and honey, but what direction do we go? So here's what God did. He showed up as a pillar of smoke during the day. Now at night you can't see a pillar of smoke. So at night, it was a fire by night. And they just follow the pillar of smoke by day and the fire by night. Now when I drive, I don't know where I'm going by a pillar of smoke and fire unless the person in front of me has major engine problems. But normally, I mean that's, when you actually see a pillar of smoke taking you someplace and it gets dark out and then a pillar of fire shows up and takes you someplace, you know what that's called? That's called a miracle. And why can God do miracles? Because He's almighty. That's right. You guys are so smart. I knew it. You must not be drinking Moxie. So the Israelites traveled. And they got to the edge of the Red Sea. And then Moses had a problem. Because you see, Pharaoh, what kind of heart did Pharaoh have? Hard heart, right. So even though he saw the mighty hand of God, he saw how almighty God is. You know your heart can become so hardened that even then, you can still sin against the Lord. He let all of the Hebrew people out, and the Hebrew people, God gave them favor in the eyes of the Egyptians. All the Egyptians said, you know what, leave, get out of here, but take our gold. Take our silver, take our cattle, take our stuff. The Hebrew people became rich at the hands of the Egyptians. That's what God did for these slaves, who were slaves for so many years. And still, Pharaoh said, you know what? What did I do? I let my slaves go free. I'm going to kill them. And Pharaoh did. He mounted up with his soldiers and his horses and his chariots and his swords and his spears and all of that. And can you imagine getting stuck at the Red Sea? The sea is on one side. And now you hear some thump. Let's hear some horses. And so it's so loud, you hear a big army of horses, and you look up, and you see sand everywhere, and smoke. Okay, enough with the horses. And you see the armies of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. How do you feel when you look and you see that?
Scared?
Terrified? I bet all that sand in the desert instantly becomes a cat box. If you know what I mean. Think about it. Anyway, yes, terrified, horrified. They're coming to kill me. In fact, even the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, the people of God, they complained against God and against Moses. And they said, why did you bring us out in the desert to die? Were there not enough graves in Egypt? We were happy in Egypt. Were they happy in Egypt? No, they were slaves in Egypt. They were toiling 7 days a week. They were being treated worse than a salt guy here at Camp Fairhaven, right? They had to do all the work and all the, and they, you know, and they could be sold and they could be whipped and they could be beaten and they could be killed. But now, because of their fear, you know, fear makes you see things in a dopey way. Sometimes when our emotions get the better of us, we're like, oh, you know, life was better back in Egypt. No, it wasn't. And God did not bring out His people to kill them in the desert. That's not what He did. I want to read to you from the word of the Lord. Exodus chapter 14, starting at verse 10. As As Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and panicked when they saw the Egyptians overtaking them. Yeah, I bet they panicked. I would too. So would you. They cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, "Why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt?" Do you hear that complaining? Why did you make us leave Egypt? That was the greatest miracle that they had ever seen, that they left Egypt. And now they're like, why did you make us do that? Didn't we tell you this would happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. Now they're rewriting history. That's not what they said, and that's not what they thought. But Moses told the people, don't be afraid. Guys, I want to tell you, whatever trial you're struggling with, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. This is one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible, verse 14 of chapter 14. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. How awesome is that? The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. And even though the people were grumbling, and even though the people were complaining, God was going to work. What he did was, there was nothing to stop Pharaoh from swooping in and killing all the Hebrews. So that pillar of fire that had led them, instead of being in front of them, the Bible says it went behind them. And it formed a wall protecting them from the Egyptians. And so now there's a pillar of fire keeping the Egyptians from attacking them temporarily. Now, the pillar of fire is generally moved from one side of a great number of people to another side of a great number of people.
No.
No! What's that called when that happens?
Miracle.
It's called a miracle, right. And you'd think that Pharaoh, at what point does Pharaoh go, you know what? I just saw 10 nasty plagues, and now I see fire moving. At what point does Pharaoh say, you know what? Maybe I'm a little too far here. Maybe I shouldn't be messing with these people. But you know what? This is what happens when your heart gets hardened. When your heart gets hardened, you do dopey things. Smart people, when they have hard hearts, do dopey things. Do not let your hearts get hardened, please. And God said to Moses, take your staff and wave it over the waters. He's not holding a staff. Who said that?
I am.
Yeah, what's your name?
Arabis.
What is it?
Arabis.
Well, you know what I have to say to you? Because I was the king of the staff. So there you go, know-it-all. It means I love you. Hey, when someone makes fun of you, my mother always told me that when someone makes fun of you, it means that they love you. And I can tell you from experience that wherever I go my whole life, people love me a lot. So it's okay. Right, yeah. And then what happened was the water of the Red Sea, it began to build up and build up and build up and build up. It became like a wall on one side and on the other side. And a lot of people know about the parting of the Red Sea, that the water parted. But one of the little details in the Bible that sometimes you don't think about is that, and I love it, it says that the ground became dry. Now, if somehow this beautiful lake that we have out here, if we could get it to dry up, like say we could get it to part, let's say we could drain the lake out here, how many months would it be before you could actually bring chariots out there? It'd be months, because the ground would be so muddy, like down for feet and feet and feet, you'd sink. It would take so long for the sun to beat on that and turn it into dry ground. And I want to propose to you that, yes, it was a great miracle that the water parted, but it was also a great miracle that the ground became dry. I mean, that's amazing. Dry and empty. That way the people, with their cattle, whatever they had that was wheeled or whatever they had, they could go, they could cross safely on dry ground. And you know what? Because they know, well, they're about to find out, that God saves. God did not bring them out in the wilderness to die, and they should not have stayed in Egypt. God saves. In fact, one day, God's going to send his own son to earth, and the angel's going to tell Mary, I want you to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. The name Jesus actually means God saves. He saved back then. He saves today. The people walk on dry ground, and you'd think that Pharaoh at some point would say, whoa, look at that water stand up. Look at the people, and they're not sinking into the mud. And their cattle isn't sinking into the mud and getting stuck. Maybe I should turn around and go home. But no, his heart was
hardened.
And when you have a hard heart, you do stupid things. And that fire went away. And Pharaoh tragically. And we don't take any joy in this. We don't take joy in the death of the wicked. He pursued the Israelites. He made it safely to the other side. Let's give them heads. This is how you get ahead in life. I only painted a few over here, but there's more than 2 million of them. Some of them are women. And someone has to tell the men that they're not dressed properly. And then another miracle happened. A horrible miracle. A miracle that teaches us that sin is serious. Don't mess with God. God told Moses, take your staff again. Now he's on the other side, and the Egyptians are in the middle. They're in where in between the columns of water that are standing up miraculously. And he says, Moses, move your staff again. And the water that was standing up came down and drowned every single Egyptian. And what that tells us, look, let me ask you a question. Who made the Egyptians? Who's their maker? God. Is God allowed to judge that which he made? Yes, he is. God is not unjust for bringing punishment on the Egyptians, because we all deserve punishment. He told Adam and Eve that if you sin, you will die. One sin, and you will die. That's all it takes. Just one. Did the Egyptians do one sin? Yes, all of them did. The question isn't, why did God judge the Egyptians and punish them? The question should be, why didn't he drown everybody? Why did he show mercy to the Israelites? Why did he show mercy to them? They're not any better. And the answer is, God will show mercy on who he gets to show mercy, and he'll use judgment on who he went to do judgment. We are the clay, he is the potter. He gets to decide. There is a day that's coming when God will judge the whole world, not just Egypt, everybody. And God will not be unjust to punish everybody on the day of judgment. Will you be ready? Will you have a savior? Because here's the good news. Here's the great news. Is that God warns us this is coming, and he gives us an opportunity to repent. Pharaoh had lots of opportunities to repent. He had 10 plagues. At any time, he could have said, all right, I'm done. All right, yep, the Lord is the Lord. I am not. Maybe I'm going to turn around and leave the Egyptians alone, the Israelites alone. So I take no pleasure in telling you that the Egyptian army was destroyed, because God is severe and God is hard, but he's good and he's just and he's right. He made the Egyptians. He can judge them. He made you and me. He can judge us, and he's not unfair. And you think the people, after seeing this great miracle, at what point did the Hebrews say, you know what? We have a God who's taking care of us. He's taking care of us when we were in Egypt. He's taking care of us in the desert. He led us with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire at night. He took good care of us, so he's always going to take care of us. We're full of faith. But that's not what the people did. They got to the other side, and yeah, they praised God. They sang a song of deliverance. But then they complained. Again, as the people made camp, as Moses, lots and lots of people with lots of heads. How many people?
Not 2 million.
2 million, at least. Sure. enough graves in Egypt that you brought us out here to die, Moses? Why are we here? We have nothing to eat. Why do you want to kill us? I mean, they're just complaining. Even though God has shown himself in many miracles, they're complaining, complaining, complaining. And Moses said, all right, watch what God's going to do. And the next day, God rained bread. Bread just showed up on the ground. Bread. I mean, I don't know about you. I mean, I know how to get bread. I go to Hannaford's or Market Basket and I buy bread. But they went out and they saw this bready substance. It tasted kind of like honey. It had a seedy taste to it. And they go, what is this? And the Hebrew word for what is this is mazeh. And from that we get the word manna. They saw this manna on the ground. What is this? And God said, I'm going to give you enough of it every day for one day. I want you to trust me every day. So on Monday, you will get enough bread. You will get enough manna for Monday. Don't take Monday and Tuesday's worth. Trust me for every day. If you take Tuesday's worth, if you take more than you need in one day, at the end of the one day, the next day, what you took the day before, it's going to turn into maggots and turn smelly and gross. Because I want you to trust me every day. And that's why many years later, when Jesus prayed, he said, give us this day our daily bread. See, God provides for us every day. We trust him in an ongoing way. Jesus was making reference to this bread in the wilderness. In fact, Jesus even said, I am the bread of life. I'm the one that sustains you and fills you supernaturally. The bread of life. But then, they said, but we want meat. So here's what God did, because God is so good. Instead of saying, I can't believe you guys are just complaining so much. No, God is good. So he had these birds, quail, fly in, and he had them fly really, really close to the ground, so that just about anybody could just grab it and eat it. Smack it against a rock and eat the quail. Got meat from the air, bread from the ground. And God said, here's the thing. Now, what happens if you take too much bread? You hoard it. What does it turn into the next day?
Maggots
and growth. Can I get your question at the end? Is that all right? So, here's the deal. God said, I want you to rest for a day. Rest for a day. These were slaves. They didn't know anything about resting. They never rested for a day. They weren't ever given days off. They were slaves. And God's like, I want you to do nothing for a day. Imagine what that must have sounded like to a slave. Wow. And I don't want you to get manna. Oh, we'll go hungry. It's okay. The day before, I will give you extra. You can pick extra that day. But it'll turn to maggots and it'll turn nasty. You've already seen that happen. God says, not on the Sabbath. Not on the special day. And God supernaturally, miraculously provided bread from the ground, provided meat from the sky, made it not get maggoty and wormy on the Sabbath day. That is a miracle. And still, can you believe that the people, they still complain? Well, because they don't have any heads. This is how you get a head of life. It's funny. You guys are going to tell that joke. One day you're going to be out, you might be 23 years old, and you're going to be drawing somebody, and you're going to draw a little face, and you're going to say, that's how you get ahead in life. And you're going to be like, oh man, that preacher, I'm never afraid, and I can't believe, I just told this joke. They said, we're going to die. We're thirsty. And that makes sense. But, you know, how many times does God have to do miracles to show that he's God, he's going to take care of you? And so God said, Moses, here's what I want you to do. Take your staff. And beat it against a type of thought to beat it against a rock, which is interesting because, you know, why don't you beat it against a plant or beat it against a camel with a hump or make watermelons show up or something? But it's like rock is like the most opposite of water thing that I can think of. In fact, even in Pokemon, aren't they like opposite each other? Rock type and water types? All right. I still like the Gyarados. Anybody like the Gyarados? It's pretty cool. Oh. All right. But anyway, that's me trying to be hip as a kiss.
Yeah.
And so Moses hit the staff against the rock, and miraculously, water came out. And not just a little, but enough for all the people to drink, to bathe, to get cool, to get refreshed, because that's a miracle. Why can God do miracles? Because God is almighty. Why can God do miracles?
Because God
is almighty. And you know what? You can learn about this And you can understand it, and you'll still complain. Because you and I, and so will I, we're not any different than the Israelites. We are complainers. But you know what? With God's help, let's be full of faith instead of full of complaints. Because God has done miracles in your life. He has. He made you. He's protected you. He's sustained you. There are people in your life who love you, maybe not as many as you'd like. There are people in your life that love you. There's certainly lots of people here who love you. God has been good to you and to me. Let's remember what God has done, because we are very prone to complain. If we just take our hand off the wheel, we will become such complainers so easily. And look, I admit it, I do it too. May we be filled with faith in the Almighty God, the God of Israel, who did so many miracles then, who can and will do so many miracles now. God's not done with the Israelites. He's going to do amazing things. He's going to teach them how people get forgiven of their sins. Ah, I love that. God's going to send Moses up on Mount Sinai to teach them something very special. And I can't wait to tell you all about it
tomorrow.
Until then, think about how mighty, almighty God is. And think about whether or not we want to be complainers or we want to be praisers. And my prayer is that you guys become praiser people. Is that really a word? Praiser people. Praiseful people. To the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, he's worth it. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for taking good care of us. You have done miracles in our life. You've done miracles in the life of your people going all the way back to Adam. You are good. You are great. You made the seas wipe away the enemies of your people. Because sin has consequences. It hardens our hearts. It sends us to hell. Lord, please, don't just give us manna and meat and water, but give us salvation. Please, fill our souls eternally. And I pray that every single young man and woman here will be ready for that, will have a heart that's ready to receive it. That if there are any stony hearts in this room, that you will change those hearts into soft, fleshly hearts. Thank you. I praise you in the name that is most worthy, the name of Jesus. And all the happy campers at Camp Fair Haven say,
amen.
All right. Great job paying attention. I love you guys. See you tomorrow. Hey everybody, this is Mark. Hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, please click like and subscribe to the channel. Please visit our website, luke-15.org. We have tons of free resources. Everything's free to help you to become a better, more effective ambassador for Jesus Christ. There's also information at luke-15.org about what my family and I do as missionaries here in New England and really everywhere through the internet. Please share these resources with other people you know through social media. And may God bless you as you take the gospel of Jesus Christ to the lost. We love Jesus. How can we not share him with others? Have a great day.